cells the fundamental unit of life. If you remember, in our previous session, we've seen the basic difference between a living and a non-living thing. And we've also seen some of the characteristics shown by a living organism. And today we'll be looking at the first characteristic in detail, which is the composition of an organism. But I want you to imagine the trees in the forest, the fish in the river, the birds in the sky, a worm in the soil, the tiger in the jungle, the cactus in the desert, or your classmates sitting next to you. All these things that I mentioned, or in fact any living thing on this planet, is made up of cells, which are known to be the building blocks of a living thing. And many cells come together to form a living organism. But besides this, some organisms like bacteria are made up of only one cell. One-celled organism is altogether an individual itself, which can perform all the functions like any other multicellular organism. So as we all know, every organism performs various functions during its entire lifespan, like say respiration, digestion, excretion, reproduction, etc. And the body has specific organs to carry out these functions. These organs are made up of various types of tissues, and tissues are nothing but a group of cells. So we can say that the human body is composed of many cells. Just as bricks form the important part of a building, cells make up an organism. So we can say that the cells are the basic fundamental unit of life. But how were the cells discovered? So let's come to that. In 1665, Robert Hooke discovered cells. He observed dead cells within the cork of a bark of a tree using an old basic microscope. He observed empty spaces contained by a wall and named them cells because they resembled small compartments. So now we can say that what Robert Hooke actually observed looks something similar to a honeycomb structure. And now we look at some of the features of a cell. So let's get started. Number of cells. Based on the number of cells, an organism can either be unicellular or multicellular. As the word suggests, you can see uni is one cell, and on the other hand, multi means many cells. So an example of a unicellular organism can be amoeba, and for a multicellular organism, it's humans. Second one is shape of a cell. Cells are of various shapes. Majority of them are round, spherical, and elongated. But do you know what exactly gives a cell its shape? Just like a room gets its shape from the walls, a cell gets its shape from a cell membrane, which is the outer covering of the cell. So talking about shape of cells, you know a unicellular organism named amoeba has no definite shape. It is irregular and it keeps changing its shape. On the other hand, in multicellular organisms, cells are of different shapes. Like for example, a nerve cell is long and branched in structure, and while an RBC, that's a red blood cell, is spherical and concave. Coming to size of a cell. So, cells are very tiny in size and are not visible to the eye. Hence, to view them, we use a microscope, which is an instrument that magnifies and enlarges the image of a cell. So, did you know that a smallest cell is 0.1 to 0.5 micrometer, which is a bacteria, while the largest cell, which is 170 millimeter into 130 millimeter in size, and it's an egg of an ostrich. But you know, you all must know this, that the size of a cell is based on the function it performs and not on the size of an organism. So when I say nerve cell, the nerve cell will be of the same size in an elephant and a rat. Till now, we have been saying that biology is all about study of life. But like we just saw, life is composed of many cells which come together to form a living organism. Our planet consists of a vast number of creatures. Some may be formed of just one cell, like we've seen in an amoeba, while others are multicellular. Number of cells can vary depending on the size of an organism. Just like the elephant and the rat example,
One more example is that an elephant will obviously have more number of cells compared to a rat, but the size of a cell will remain the same. Also, cells have a property of regeneration. So imagine that you've got a wound on your knee and your skin cells are damaged. But your body has a tendency to regenerate those cells on its own. And this is a process of healing because of the body immunity. And this regeneration property is the most fascinating property of cells.
So when we study a cell, we need to know that what is a cell composed of? So to tell you, a cell has many components which help in the proper functioning of the cell. And we'll be looking at them in the next session. So till then, why don't you try a small exercise? During this entire session, I've tried naming a few cells found in the human system, like say for example an RBC. So can you try listing down the other types of cells found in the human system? Keep thinking about it. And till the next session, try following your curiosity. Do subscribe to know more on biology. And if you have any questions, you can ask me in the comments below. Thank you so much.